So let me first of all thank the organizer for the very kind invitation. It's a pleasure, it's an honor, it's also a responsibility. And the best way in which you can help me is by asking as many questions as come to your mind at any time, okay? These lectures are gonna be, I start from the right, well, from the left of the blackboard. These lectures are gonna be on composite ticks. Which, as the name says, is the idea that the Higgs boson could be a composite particle with a compositeness scale, okay, which means with the geometric sides not far from its mass. And the first reason to try to ask whether this could really be the case is a bit heuristic, but it sounds rather strong. Namely, we know that all the other spin zero scalar bosons that have been observed, perhaps aside from the Higgs or perhaps not, are indeed composite particles. The only spin zero particles we know are hadrons of QCD, like the pions, the sigma, kaons. And for this particle, what I just said, it holds. They are composite particles, which means that they have a non-vanishing geometric sides. They have a typical length, which you can measure, for instance, with the electromagnetic radius of the pions or of the proton or of the other QCD hadrons, which is of the order of 1 over lambda QCD, the QCD confinement scale. And their mass is indeed of the same order, right? Of the inverse of the length, that is of the order of lambda QCD, okay? So this was true for all the other scalars. Could this be true also for the Higgs that we just discovered? Here it's important to be more precise because we are gonna use a lot this fact. Actually, there are some hadrons which are for which this relation does not hold. Their mass is not exactly set by the QCD scale, but it's a bit below that, okay? Not by so much, but this is gonna be important. These particles, as you know, are the pions, okay? And they are a bit lighter than the QCD scale because they are Goldstone bosons. And this concept is gonna come back in a second. So this to me is a very heuristic motivation. It's probably, in my opinion, not the main one for studying composite ticks. The main motivation for studying composite ticks is the hierarchy problem, or naturalness problem, and so the fact that the presence of a geometric size of the Higgs, so a compositeness scale of the Higgs not too far, let's say, from the TV scale, so composite Higgs, solves the hierarchy problem. I will tell you more about the hierarchy problem and the composite tick solution in 10 minutes or so. But before doing that, let me just outline the main concepts and ideas that are important for the study of composite ticks. This will be a sort of plan of the lectures of the subject that I'm gonna touch. So composite ticks theories are characterized by two main physical concepts or physical ideas that I will describe in turn. The first one is that, so the Higgs is a composite state, but not only that. The Higgs is a specific composite state. The Higgs is a composite Nambu Goldstone boson. Okay? Well, I forgot to say, but it's rather obvious. The Higgs must be the bound state, but it cannot be the bound state of QCD. It will never make it to make a resonance of 125 GeV. So if I want to study this possibility that the Higgs is composite, I have to introduce a new confining strong force. Okay? An entire new sector conceptually or say naively similar to the QCD theory that confines and delivers resonances among which the Higgs. And furthermore, this composite sector theory must be endowed with a global symmetry. Okay? And this global symmetry must be spontaneously broken. And this is what makes arise, as you know, I think very well, special particles, which are Nambu-Goldstone bosons. Okay? And the Higgs, these are composite states as well, like the pions of QCD, but they are different from the other bound states of the theory. In particular, they are naturally much more light because of the spontaneously broken global symmetry. Okay, so the Higgs is going to be a special hadron of this new strong sector, a Nambu-Goldstone boson. Actually, the Higgs, you know, is not exactly a Nambu-Goldstone boson because, in particular, it has a mass, and so it's actually going to be a pseudo Nambu-Goldstone boson. Okay, so why we need this hypothesis to start with? I already anticipated. So we want a situation where the Higgs has a geometric length, like the other composite states. The length of the Higgs is now not set by lambda QCD, but it's set by another scale of confinement that I call M star. Okay, and this is the scale of confinement of the new strongly interacting sector. And the situation we want. We have in mind is the following one. So a generic composite sector, like, for instance, if you open the particle data group, you discover that there are plenty of hadrons, okay? And most of these hadrons, including protons, neutrons, and others, they share more or less a common mass, which is the lambda QCD scale, okay? So the composite sector is going to behave in the same way. And so we are going to imagine to have a wide set of more or less narrow resonances, similarly to the one that have been observed for ages in hadron spectroscopy physics in the case of QCD, more or less all of them with the same mass, okay? Perhaps not narrowly degenerate, but let's say this has mass 1, this has mass 2, 3, and 4, okay? And, oh, already, please. Because the QCD scale is 300 MeV, 1 GeV, and so you cannot have a particle that weighs 125 GeV by QCD, okay?
Andrea, if you can repeat the question.
No, the question was just that why not to consider the Higgs as a hadron, as a QCD hadron, okay? And the answer is that QCD confinement is so low that it's impossible. If you want at 125 GeV, QCD has already deconfined, and so you know it's not going to produce resonances at that scale. So what I was saying is that our composite sector, even without knowing anything about that, is expected to give a whole set of particles at the scale M star. These particles are called the resonances. Okay? The resonance bound states of the composite sector. Now, if the Higgs has to be one of these hadrons, we will be in deep phenomenological problems, okay? Because if you pick randomly any of those hadrons, it will be surrounded by particles all more or less with the same mass, somebody above, somebody below. And of course, we have only observed one resonance at the LHC, and we know that there is no other electroweak charged or even colored resonances up to 1 TeV or so. So what we really want is that the Higgs is not inside this, grid of resonances, but is detached, is below, okay? It has a lower mass. This is naturally what happens if the Higgs is a pseudo-Nambu-Goldstone boson, because a Goldstone boson is an exactly massless particle if the Goldstone symmetry is exactly a symmetry, okay, spontaneously broken, but with no sources of explicit breaking. It can acquire a little bit of mass, but its mass is not controlled directly by this M star, but it can be made, up and down, okay, as much as you like, if the perturbation that breaks spontaneously the Goldstone symmetry is small, okay? So the first reason why the Higgs should be a Goldstone boson and not a random resonance is that we want to explain why the Higgs mass is below the M star, is below the confinement scale. This is why it is below the scale of these other resonances that I want to take more or less in the TV range or multi-TV. Okay? Okay. In spite of this, there is still people entertaining the possibility that the Higgs could actually just be one of these random guys. Okay? Please. I know that I want to have M star at TV or multi-TV scale because, the question was why I want to put M star at the TV scale. The reason is, of course, phenomenology. The Higgs carries electroweak quantum numbers. So electroweak quantum numbers must be present in this sector. So the resonances of this sector will carry electroweak quantum numbers. The most dangerous one are spin one electroweak charged bosons, for which the bound is of around two or something like this TV. Okay? Please. No, I will repeat the question. Now I understood how it works.
So if I understand the idea of composite net correctly, and if I draw an analogy with the standard QCD, then in QCD, the scale of compositeness, it will be 300 MeV or so. And we know that proton is a composite object, and its mass is higher than the QCD compositeness. It's 1 GeV. So if I draw the analogy, then the Higgs mass should be higher than the compositeness scale if I do... because proton is a composite object and the
I think, if I understand properly the question, in QCD you can quantify lambda QCD as the place where there is the pole, right? And this gives the 300 MeV that you are mentioning, okay? However, aside from the Goldstone bosons, from the pions, which are light for a reason, actually the resonances of QCD are more close to the 1 GeV, right?
Yeah.
So if you average, let's say, the hadron spectrum, you should better read lambda QCD as 1 GeV rather than 300 MeV. Okay?
Yeah, but...
The important point is that whatever this... We are dealing with another sector, which has nothing to do with QCD. So we are free to place the scale where we like. Okay? Suppose we place it at the right place to reproduce the Higgs mass, 125 GeV. Then they all come down together, okay? All the resonances. And you haven't seen them. You want a gap.
Yeah, but in case of QCD, suppose the constituent particles are very light, like the proton mass is 938 MeV and the constituent quarks are of the order of MeV. So the main source of proton mass comes from the binding energy, right?
Sure.
I guess if that is the scenario with the Higgs also, with some other kind of strong interaction, then the binding energy contribution should be much higher than that. I mean, if the compositeness scale
this M star is the binding energy. In analogy with QCD, this M star is the binding energy contribution. It has nothing to do with the quark masses, okay?
Okay, so...
So the confinement scale of QCD is what has 1 GeV or 300 MeV, take it whatever you want, which sets the mass of the hadrons, has nothing to do with the constituent quarks masses.
Yeah, so that is a kind of the binding energy of the Higgs boson. I mean, that...
There should be a bilinear that breaks some symmetry and delivers a Goldstone boson. We will see it more.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah, I was saying that I wanted to tell you that there is still some activity in trying to give up this hypothesis. Okay, not to treat the Higgs as a Goldstone boson, but as one of these resonances. Okay, none of these proposals, as far as I know, have a structural reason why the Higgs should be lighter. So they are able to explain in a natural way why the spectrum looks like this. And moreover, this kind of proposal are in tension with another important property we should ask to the Higgs to be physical. Namely, the fact that by now we have measured the Higgs couplings. Not very precisely, but we do have measured them. Okay? And also the Higgs couplings, they enter indirectly In other observables, in lab physics, there are very precise calculations done in which you have also to include loops that involve the coupling, for instance, of the Higgs boson with the electroweak bosons. Okay? And so indirectly, we know that these couplings have to be not too far from, let's say, 20% or 10% to what is predicted by the standard model. And the standard model, of course, the Higgs is not composite. It's an eminently elementary guy. And again, if the Higgs was just a random resonance lost here in the middle of the spectrum, there would be no reason for this to happen. Okay? The couplings would be allowed, all of them, to deviate at order one. Instead, if the Higgs is a pseudonambu-Goldstone boson, by a mechanism due to Georgi and Kaplan and collaborators, which I will explain, and is called, say, vacuum misalignment, okay, I will tell you which vacuum I'm misaligned with respect to what. So it is a mechanism by which you can systematically recover a Higgs particle emerging as a pseudonambu-Goldstone boson with couplings that are arbitrarily close to those of the elementary standard model. Okay. More precisely, there's going to be one parameter, which is called the misalignment angle, that if you take it small enough, you can make the Higgs look like an elementary particle as much as you like. Okay? Taking this parameter small, as far as we understand, there is not a consensus of a structural reason for taking this misalignment angle small. So this could either be something that we should still invent, or it could be the result of some little amount of cancellation, which, however, for this to make sense, should not exceed, say, 1 into 10 or something like this. Okay? So just keep in mind that inside vacuum misalignment, there is one fine-tuning taking place. Only one, however, that controls all the X couplings. And more than that, and other observables as well. Okay? Okay. So that's the first important physical idea. The second important physical idea is more technical. I will just tell you the name. Basically, it's called partial fermion compositeness. Okay. And this has to do with the way in which we couple the fermions, the matter fermions, the quarks and the lepton, with the composite sector. And since the composite sector contains the Higgs, this is unavoidable. We want to couple the fermions with the Higgs in order to generate their mass, okay, and to give rise to the Yukawas, okay, all things that we start also having observed, okay? But the mass much before. Okay? So we will see that there are two ways to do that. One way is doesn't work, and the way that works seems to be this one. Okay, for you to keep in mind, this hypothesis on the way in which we will make the fermions communicate with the composite sector seems to be really mandatory. Okay, not to run into inconsistency. Only actually for the top quark. Okay, and perhaps also for the bottom. Okay. So just to say that we are sort of convinced that this is the right thing for the top, for the other quarks. One may consider alternatives. Still, it's an open model building activity on this. Okay, so this was the most important part, the physical ideas, but there are also technical tools that perhaps are the main obstruction in for people trying to understand this stuff. Technical tools. Okay. So the main technical tools we will need to study the implication of these physical ideas, and that I will try to briefly summarize, are first one, the physics of non-linearly realized symmetries. So a nonlinearly realized symmetry is a spontaneously broken symmetry. It's a synonym. Okay? We call it nonlinearly realized on purpose because a spontaneously broken symmetry is not broken. Okay? It's indeed realized on the physical fields in a complicated nonlinear way. But the fact that it's realized in a complicated nonlinear way doesn't mean at all that the symmetry, okay, still doesn't have a lot of predictive power. In particular, it has a lot of predictive power on the physics of the pseudo-Nambu-Goldstone bosons, that is, on the physics of the Higgs. And we will use this, okay, to make predictions. So in particular, we will compute the prediction for the leading order, okay, in a momentum expansion. Okay, so the leading order corrections of the couplings of the Higgs to standard model particles. Okay, so we will compute the Higgs coupling to vector bosons and the Higgs coupling to fermions. Okay. Okay. The second tool is called power counting. And it is needed basically to go beyond what we can say only on the basis of symmetries. Okay. Power counting means that you have a low energy effective Lagrangian whose operators you can predict by symmetries, okay, but whose coefficient you cannot predict by symmetry. Okay, it's a free parameter. And power counting is, in the first place, a way to estimate the size of this coefficient. It's not going to give us a definite prediction, only up to order one number, but it is absolutely essential, first of all, to make us sure that the leading order prediction that per X are fixed by symmetries, like the X coupling modification, are actually robust, because the corrections can be estimated to be small. And furthermore, the power counting rule that we will derive is going to be important to describe the physics of resonances. You know that resonances that I wanted to be heavy enough not to be seen, still we hope them that they are light enough to be seen now at the LHC RAN 2. And so we would like to describe and parameterize in some useful way their phenomenology, and also for this we need power counting. Okay? Just to mention a final two-prime tool, which I will just mention, I will not discuss in any detail, So I will not discuss at all, are phenomenological models. Okay. So you may have heard about these models, even though perhaps you are too young. In particular, the very popular models of composite X were the five-dimensional holographic models. So, which are interesting quantum field theory things, also because of their possible connection with weak and strong coupling duality, okay? And they are formulated as theories in five-dimensional space, typically with a Wolf factor, Alexander-Sundrum. They were historically very important because they provided a first representative example of all these two okay, physical ideas, okay? X as a Nambu-Goldstone boson and partial fermion compositeness. They are all inside these interesting kind of constructions. Okay? But I'm not going to discuss them because it's technically too much. Okay? Okay, this was the plan of the lectures. If there are questions or special requests, if not, I go to the. I start. I want to start by the motivations, okay, as one should do. So by the motivations of the composite ticks, that is the hierarchy problem and the way in which composite ticks solves the hierarchy problem and under which hypothesis. But even before that, okay, let me remind you, I'm sure Marcus already explained this to you, that the standard model of particle physics is, for sure, right, an effective field theory. So sometimes people say let's interpret the standard model as an effective field theory, like if it was, I think you can or cannot do. The standard model is an effective field theory, okay? And we are sure that the standard model is an effective field theory because it has a cutoff, which is it has a massive maximal energy, which we call lambda standard model, above which it is not applicable. It doesn't give prediction. It's wrong, okay? The only thing is that we don't know where this scale is. We have an absolute upper bound on this scale, which is provided by the Planck mass, which is where the perturbative semiclassical description of gravity, which is inside the standard model, breaks down. But this scale is very high, okay? 10 to the 18 GeV. So if the standard model cutoff was really that high, in a certain sense, we would be, say, tempted to regard it as a fundamental theory, given that in practice, I mean, who knows when we will ever be able to reach such a big energy. Okay. And I think you are all familiar with effective field theories, and in particular with low energy effective field theories, that is theories that are valid below a certain threshold of energy. But I just want to recall you a couple of concepts taken from the simplest example of a low energy effective field theory, which is of course the Fermi theory. Okay? So the Fermi theory works as follows. In the scale of energies, okay, at a certain point you hit the W mass, and you have a complete description of physics, of electroweak interactions, that goes from zero up to above the W mass, okay, quite above, which is the electroweak theory, or if you want the standard model, but here it only matters the electroweak theory part of the standard model. Okay. Below the critical threshold, which is provided by the W boson mass, you know that, the Ws cannot be produced, so we can compute, we can define an effective field theory in which there is no W particles and there is only the fermions, and the Fermi theory holds from the W mass below. Okay? And the Fermi theory is an effective description of the electroweak theory, and we are sure about this because we can really compute the Fermi theory Lagrangian starting from the electroweak theory, okay, by integrating out the W boson, the thing you have seen in all textbooks. So the Fermi Lagrangian. Now we know that is some parameter G Fermi, psi bar psi square. Plus all possible higher order correction that come when I integrate out the W and expand the propagator. You know, this gives a lot of higher derivative operators. But the leading order contribution to GF comes from this diagram with the W in between, and it is GW square over 4 square root of 2 MW square. Okay? So conceptually, we know that the Fermi constant is not a fundamental parameter, it's an effective field theory parameter. We know that it is derived from the electroweak theory because we are able to compute it, and we input GW and MW, we get the right value, and so we know that electroweak theory is the microscopic UV completion of the Fermi theory, which is the theory that stops down here. Okay? Now, for the standard model, one day, we will be able to do the same operation, okay? One day we will know the equivalent of the electroweak theory, okay? The one that holds at very high scales, above the standard model cutoff. And we will be able to compute the standard model Lagrangian, okay? As an effective Lagrangian originating from a more fundamental theory. And trying to guess what this fundamental theory is, of course, the job of BSM physics, and is what compositics model building is done for. Okay, so the picture is like this. In the scale of energies, there is the Planck mass, or some other very high scale. It doesn't matter much. Okay, they are the same as infinity, as far as this discussion, well, to some extent, proceeds. This is the GATT scale of 10 to the 16 GeV, which could be also another critical scale in physics. And at this scale, you have some theory which we really don't know anything about. It could be a string theory. There could be GATT or whatever else. Now, below the Planck mass, and perhaps also below NGATT, but well, doesn't matter much, we have the standard model cutoff, okay? And the only thing we know about the standard model cutoff is that it should be above the electroweak scale, because this is where we have tested the standard model, okay? So, as I told you, the problem is that we don't know really where to place this thing in a wide, in extremely wide range of energies. So by knowing this fundamental theory, which of course I don't know, I will be able to obtain the standard model as an effective Lagrangian. So I will reduce myself to a low energy theory below the standard model cutoff, which contains only the standard model particles and the standard model symmetries. Which are the Lorentz symmetry and of course gauge invariance. And I will integrate out all the heavy particles that arise at lambda standard model and above, okay? And I will obtain an effective standard model Lagrangian, like for the Fermi theory. So one day I will be able to compute the standard model Lagrangian, compute its parameters in terms of this more fundamental theory. So what I'm gonna get? I'm simply gonna get as for the Fermi theory, I'm going to get the most general possible Lagrangian, which contains the standard model fields and is invariant under the standard model symmetries. And what I can usefully do is to classify the possible terms that I get into the Lagrangian by their dimension in energy, okay, d. So there will be the operators in the Lagrangian of dimension 4. Okay? The Lagrangian itself has dimension 4. So the prefactor here is a dimensionless number. Okay? Then there will be operators of dimension 5. Since the Lagrangian must have dimension 4, this must be 1 over lambda standard model. Oh, well, this must have a negative energy dimension. How do I estimate? By just dimensional analysis what is the number I have to put here? Okay, it's obviously lambda standard model because it's the result of some physics taking place at this scale, so that's the only scale I can put. Okay. For instance, in the case of the Fermi theory, the scale that controls higher derivative corrections when I expand the propagator is just p square, the momentum, which is the derivative square, over mw square. Okay, and here it's going to be the same thing. So dimension 5, and then of course I can continue, there is dimension 6, which is weighted by 1 over lambda standard model square. Okay. Okay, so that's what I'm gonna get. And Now what I will try to argue or to discuss is what I can infer from observation, okay, concerning these various terms in the Lagrangian and concerning the expected size of this lambda standard model. Okay? So when we say that perhaps there is only the standard model, okay, you know, what we really mean is that so the so-called standard model only option. Okay? Is that lambda standard model is huge. And a critical place where to put it, just to fix the ideas more or less, but suppose the standard model cutoff is at the order of the gut scale of 10 to the 15 GeV. Okay? This scale has a reason, and I will briefly mention why in a second. So this option, which is the option of no new physics at colliders, for instance, there is new physics also here, right? Dark matter, other things. But this option here is strongly supported if you look at these operators here. Okay? If you look at d equal 4, 5, 6, d, large, d equal or larger than 4 operators, this picture is very strongly supported. Because at d equal 4, the Lagrangian you get is just the Lagrangian of the standard model as it appears on the CERN T-shirt, okay? Which is the normalizable standard model Lagrangian that was written down in the early days. And we know that this works very well, okay? So this is the T-shirt standard model. So this accounts for basically, I mean, naively, all what we have seen, okay? Aside from important issues, you know, there is the strong CP problem, the CP phase is equal to zero, but it's dimension four, so it's not suppressed, why? There is no dark matter, right? Okay? There is no candidate for inflation, baryogenesis, okay? But the point is that all these issues, which are of course serious issues, could be solved, okay? Just by physics at, say, either very weakly coupled, so that is irrelevant in this argument, or very heavy, okay, which is exactly at the gut scale or above, okay? If you look at d equal 5 operator, the evidence becomes even stronger, okay? Because at d equal 5, you can see that there is only one more operator to be added to the standard model Lagrangian. And this is the Weinberg operator, which is 1 over lambda standard model, the left-handed lepton doublet bar, the Higgs, okay? The Higgs conjugate, actually. Conjugate, you know, means I sigma 2 times the Higgs star, okay? It's the conjugate Higgs doublet. And then there is, this has SU2 indices which are contracted with each other. And then there is the left-handed doublet again, but this, the charge conjugate of it times the X conjugate once again. Okay? So by this only operator, okay, which comes the only one at dimension 5, you can explain neutrino masses. Okay? This gives Majorana neutrino masses, if you check it, if you look at it. Okay? And it gives Majorana neutrino masses of a size which is almost right if you take lambda standard model 10 to the 15 GeV or so. Okay? So d equal 4, d equal 5, roughly speaking, explain what we have seen and also explains why neutrinos were so light, okay? Because their mass doesn't come from some dimension 4 term like the Yukawa for the others, but it comes from a dimension 5. So the mass of the neutrinos will be suppressed by this 1 over lambda standard model huge suppression. Okay? D equals 6 operators are not so dangerous with this very high scale. For instance, if you look at, they can induce proton decay. This is the most dangerous effect they have. But they induce proton decay of an amount which is, the width of the proton over the mass of the proton, which is a good dimensionless measure of how narrow the proton is, predicted by D equals 6 operator, of course, it's not absurd, there is a bound only on this, is of the order of 1 over 8 pi, which I put just for fun, mass of the proton over lambda UV. So you see, the D equals 6 operator are weighted by 1 over lambda standard model square, okay? So I have to, in the amplitude, there is 1 over lambda standard model square. Everything goes again square because I have to make the modulus square, so all this goes like 1 over lambda standard model to the fourth. To make something dimensionless, I put the proton mass here. And this estimate is, still roughly compatible with observation, which give for this an incredibly small number of 10 to the minus 64. Okay? Now, if you look closely to the numbers, so the scale you need to do neutrino masses is in slight tension with the scale you need to do, to suppress enough proton decay. However, you should take into account that these are all estimates with one, okay, here, okay, 1 over lambda standard model, 1 over lambda standard model square. We have no idea whether this one is actually a product of couplings that can be rather small in one case and larger in the other. So qualitatively, this is still perfectly compatible, and perhaps the only sign of this could be if we are able to improve the bounds on proton decay by, say, 3 orders of magnitude, and we don't see it, this could be intention. Otherwise, it's perfectly okay. Okay? Okay, so this is to tell you how important the hierarchy problem is, because if it was not for the hierarchy problem, or if we discovered that the hierarchy problem is not reflecting in new physics at the LHC, to me, well, there would be no structural reason to destroy, say, the standard model, to change the standard model in a large way at a scale which is below around the gas scale. Okay? Of course, there are all the issues I mentioned here which have to be solved, but they could be done by some tiny deformations, not with some radical change, because you want to buy all these successes. Instead, the hierarchy problem, or the problem of naturalness, is challenging this picture in a very radical way. Because I just wrote operators of dimension 4, 5, and 6, but I forgot to write operator of dimension less than 4. And again, there is only one such operator, which is the Higgs mass term, okay, which has an energy dimension equal to 2. And so if I do dimensional analysis also for the Higgs mass term and not only for the large dimension guys, which I think I should do for consistency at least, then I find that this mass term has an estimated coefficient of some order 1 number, the standard model cutoff square, H dagger, H. Okay? So this would be the Higgs mass, but of course the Higgs is 125 GeV, so lambda standard model, we took it 10 to the 15, there is a big mismatch, which is the hierarchy problem. The hierarchy problem is asking why the Higgs mass over the standard model cutoff is in this, MGAT physics scale, is of around 10 to the minus 28, so which is much, 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 much smaller than 1. Okay? So he's asking why this is going to happen. Okay? Okay. Oops. Okay, if there are no urgent questions, let me go on. So, the hierarchy problem, the first thing you will say about the hierarchy problem is that maybe it requires new physics at the TV scale or at around the Higgs mass itself. Of course, this is what we're going to do. Keep in mind that this is a very dangerous game, because if the new physics scale is rather than 10 to the 15 GeV is, 10 to the 3 GeV, then all the higher dimensional operators become huge, okay? And so it's clear that they cannot just come, okay, with a generic order 1 coefficient. They must be strongly suppressed, okay? And indeed, model building at the TV scale is a dangerous and delicate business, okay, which comes from, which has constraint from zillion of different places. Okay, on one end. Also because of this, there is an objection you may make to the hierarchy problem in the way I stated there, which is the following. So we actually seem to have found that the Higgs mass is not equal to the standard model cutoff, but is proportional to the standard model cutoff with a proportionality factor C. And given that it looks so difficult to put the standard model cutoff light with respect to phenomenology, then it could be better to make C very small. Okay? So we could take lambda standard model at mgat, but just C of order 10 to the minus 28. Okay? Trying to find some microscopic reason for this to happen in the UV theory. Okay? This wouldn't help, actually. Because there is another way in which you can better view the hierarchy problem, which is connected with the solution offered by compositics. Okay? So this doesn't help. And the reason why this doesn't help is that the Higgs mass parameter that we estimated down there, okay, is not the full answer for the Higgs mass. Okay? It's not the physical Higgs mass. The physical Higgs mass receives other contribution. Okay? In a Wilsonian approach to the normalizability, this will be very clear. Here I just do a poor man version of the Wilson approach. Okay? So let's reason in a slightly different term. Now I'm interested in computing the Higgs mass. Okay? Because one day, again, I will know what is the fundamental theory that gives physical origin to the Higgs mass. For instance, it could be a composite theory, and this calculation can be really done. Okay, so what I'm going to write, you could put number inside. And the prediction of this Higgs mass will be performed in terms of the fundamental new theory parameters, okay, that we are going to call P fund. And we'll have an algebraic form that we are not able to predict, of course. Okay, but we can write it, we can parameterize it as follows. So the Higgs mass prediction as computed in, for instance, your favorite compositics theory, okay, is an integral over the energies, which extends from all, in all the energy range, of some function, which I don't know what it is, so I just call it dmh square over dE, something that after integrating becomes the Higgs mass, okay, which again depends on the energy scale and on the fundamental theory parameters. Okay. This energy in, say, the Wilson language would mean the shell of momenta that contribute to the Higgs mass. Okay. In our Pullman approach, this just means the energy of the virtual quanta, okay, that run into the loops that contribute to the Higgs mass. Indeed, this formula is written having in mind loop contribution to the Higgs mass. So diagrams like this with here standard model particles, but also plenty of other new particles or those that come in the fundamental theory, which I don't know. And in this case, E would be the energy of the virtual particle inside here. And what this means is that a priori the Higgs mass receives contribution from all the energy scales. Okay? E goes from zero to infinity. The formula does not prevent to be used in case of three-level contribution. Okay? For instance, in gut models, there are three-level contributions to the Higgs mass. In gut models, you can predict the Higgs mass as the difference of two masses, so of two triplet and doublet that break the SO5 gut group. Okay? And there is one place in which indeed you see the fine-tuning. But in compositics, for instance, this formula is perfect like this. You don't need to put any delta function here because there is no three-level contribution. It's only radiative contribution. And the thing that is problematic, okay, is that, again, following Wilson, I can split this integral, okay, the shell of momenta, from low energy to high energy. So I can just write this as the integral from zero to an intermediate scale that I will take to be around the standard model cutoff, but just a little bit below, okay, because I want to live in a range of energies where the standard model is more or less valid. So I have to be below its cutoff. plus the integral from this intermediate scale, okay, up to infinity. Okay. So again, this is what Wilson would call infrared contribution, and these are what we call UV contribution, because it's really what they are. So the UV contribution is basically the guy here we were estimating before, okay? It's the contribution from the physics above lambda standard model, the one we integrated out to get the X mass. So actually the X mass is not only this piece, okay? It's this piece that I call, which is the same as there, which I call delta BSM MH square. So it's the contribution to beyond the standard model physics to the X mass. But then there is also a contribution which comes from standard model physics. Okay? So this contribution gets accumulated in a range of energies where we do know the theory. The theory is the standard model. So this other contribution, delta SM of MH square, we can, well, at least estimate it by our knowledge of the standard model. Okay? What it will be? Simply, it will be the usual, say, quadratic divergence calculation. So the contribution of the X mass, so these things here, are associated with loops, like the dominant one being the one of the top, because it's the top is the guy with the largest coupling to the Higgs. There are also other contributions I'm not going to write, which has to be integrated over a range of momenta, which goes from zero to around the standard model. So standard model cutoff. So more or less it's like taking this loop, okay, interpreted the energy of that flows in the loop as this scale here, and integrating only up to the standard model cutoff. Okay? So E smaller than lambda standard model. Okay? So this calculation happens to coincide with the quadratic divergence calculation, but okay, let me insist that the quadratic divergence calculation is not a calculation because the quadratic divergence cannot be computed. Okay? But the calculation makes sense as our estimate of this physical contribution to the Higgs mass that will come in this fundamental theory that we still do not know. Okay? And the result of the calculation you know very well is 3 y top square over 8 pi square lambda standard model square. Okay? The fact that I get lambda standard model square, again, is due to the fact that this diagram is superficially quadratically divergent. Okay. So now we start seeing the problem. So I don't have to find a UV reason why this C parameter is to be tremendously small. It's not what I need, okay? Because the Higgs mass is this contribution, so delta BSM, which is proportional to this C, plus or minus, hopefully minus, okay, the contribution that comes from the standard model, which is also huge. So what I really need to do is to choose very peculiar value for C, okay, such that the beyond the standard model contribution is almost equal and opposite to the standard model part. They cancel, they fine tune, and give us the Higgs mass. Okay. So the naturalness problem is a fine-tuning problem. Okay? Which is to say that I have no obstruction, no conceptual obstruction, sorry, no technical obstruction in getting the X mass light as I want, if I just tune very precisely delta SM of MH square, almost, but really almost equal, okay, up to many digits, to minus delta BSM square. Or vice versa, I can tune, I probably want to tune delta BSM, MH square, okay? And I get the X mass that I want. The amount of fine tuning I have to do means how much cancellation I have to do among these two terms to get the result is quantified by something that's called delta, which is equal to, let's say, the standard model contribution, one or the other doesn't matter given that they are almost equal. Delta SM, MH square over the X mass square, which turns out from that estimate, okay, and knowing also the value of the X mass, is lambda standard model over 550 GV. The question is whether the calculation is gauge invariant and whether it makes sense at all, okay? So, I mean, if I wanted to do this precisely, okay, I would have probably used the Wilson approach to retronormalizability, which can be formulated. It's not in a straightforward Wilson paper, but it can be formulated in a gauge invariant proper regulator way, okay? So, here I want to give you the idea of what happens. Okay, suppose for instance, in a composite X theory, you can really compute the X potential, okay, and in particular the X mass, and put it really in this form, okay, where this guy here is some 2-point function, okay, some 2-point function that results from it's a Coleman-Weinberg term that results from an effective Lagrangian for the top, for instance, for the effective top, okay? And then what you really see there is that when you go to low energies below the standard model cutoff, well, the couplings in this effective Lagrangian just become equal to the standard model coupling, okay? And so the contribution of this integral just becomes equal to the one of the standard model, and so the contribution to the final integral that comes from energies below the standard model, it's the one you expect from the standard model. So if you want, I could have done the full calculation in that gauge, and in that gauge it's completely gauge invariant and Lorentz invariant, and you would have found the same. Okay? Thank you for the question. Okay? Okay. There are still a couple of comments I wanted to make because they are important for composite X. Before going to explain why the compositeness of the Higgs helps. Okay, in this problem. Okay. So first of all, to the problem of naturalness, you can give a quantitative sense. Okay. So if you look at the fine tuning formula, delta equal to lambda standard model over 550 GV square, you may interpret this in different ways. You may say, well, the fine tuning is a strange thing. It shouldn't happen, okay? So I expect delta to be of order one, and so new physics at 450 GV. That is, if you want, a non-quantitative interpretation. That says that after you go above this kind of threshold for in your search for new physics, you should just give up. You should accept that there is some fine tuning. Okay, and at that point, it would not matter if this fine tuning is large or small. I mean, that's just a way to estimate the place where new physics is expected to be. Or there is another more quantitative way to interpret this, so which is as follows. Again, taken from the experience in concrete models, in GATT or in composite X. So if you end up with a situation like this, in which there is a formula for the Higgs mass, okay, that is written in this form, and you find that this formula is made of two contributions which sum up, and each of these two contributions is huge, okay, but the difference is very small, then in practice, it's like you don't have, to start with, any concrete prediction for the Higgs mass. Okay? Why? Well, if I say that there is, let's say, new physics at the gut scale, it means that there is 28 digits of cancellation between here and there. Okay? And this means that, well, in my final physical formula for the Higgs mass, you would have two unrelated terms. One comes from the infrared, the other comes from the UV. And these two terms are both huge, okay? They have to be both huge, but their difference has to be cancelled to 28 digits. So if I want to predict the value of the Higgs mass only with one digit accuracy, I need the 29 digit accuracy on this part and on this part of the story, okay? Just for the same reason that 100 minus 99 is 1, but I have to know the 100 at 1% if I want to know that 1 is 1 and is not 3, okay? So in concrete, the fine-tuning issue can be viewed as a predictability issue, because I will never be able to compute these two pieces to this big accuracy, and I will never be able to compute the fundamental new physics theory parameters so accurately to check that indeed this is consistent. So in this sense, the fine-tuning can also have given a quantitative sense, and this is what people tend to do in the literature, okay? So for instance, if there is a fine-tuning of around 10, this means that my composite Higgs theory happens to have this is equal to 10, this is equal to 9, to minus 9, and the result is 1. Okay, I just have to work a little bit more to predict these two terms into the sum in order to check that the Higgs mass is what it is, okay? So tuning, let's say, equal to 10, almost okay, okay? Of course, if the tuning is of the order 10 to the 3, then, I will probably give up. Because at a certain point, if it's too challenging to achieve a true prediction of the Higgs mass from the microscopic point of view, then at a certain point, it's like that the Higgs mass has not microscopic origin, but it's a fundamental parameter, and it will remain a fundamental parameter forever, okay, as it could be. But you see, this is an important information, whether the Higgs mass and so in turn the electroweak symmetry breaking scale have a microscopic origin or it doesn't have it, okay? I think it's an interesting information that you can check because naturalness or unnaturalness are testable concepts, as you see here, okay? So if the standard model cutoff is, you can explore, okay, like now we are able to do with the LHC, standard model cutoffs of the order of the TV or multi-TV, you can access the region where this fine-tuning becomes large. Okay? Okay. And this is also the reason why in composite Higgs we don't worry too much if we have to do a fine-tuning of around 10, okay, on something. Okay. Okay, what is that composite Higgs does to address this this issue? Okay? So in supersymmetry you have seen that you can really check, okay, that you cancel this guy by means of the new physics. You can use powerful theorems. Here as well, it's a bit more complicated to explain properly, in particular because you don't have a model, okay, of these things. Okay, strongly interacting new sector behaves in a way which is difficult to do at the blackboard an example. Okay, but you can understand qualitatively in a very simple way. So again, in composite Higgs, the Higgs mass is predicted in terms of the fundamental parameter, and so you can imagine plotting the contribution to the Higgs mass from different shells of momenta, the one that enter into this formula. Okay? So dmh square over dE. Okay? So, first of all, what you get in the standard model? The usual quadratic divergence, okay? So, which means the usual linear behavior. Linear with the energy, you integrate it up a certain cutoff, you get E squared. So that's what you get. Okay? And this is what you're going to get also in composite Higgs at sufficiently low energies. Indeed, there is this threshold, which is the confinement scale M star, that corresponds to the inverse of the sides of the Higgs. Again, LH 1 over m star. And this part of the plot here at energies below m star corresponds to virtual quanta was wavelength, okay, given that energy is small, the wavelength is large in comparison with the size of the Higgs. Okay? So this is like this. And so, or even more, and so the Higgs, the fact that the Higgs has a size doesn't matter, the Higgs behaves like an elementary thing. Okay? When instead you consider energies which are much above m star, the wavelength of the wave of the virtual quantum you are studying the effect of is much smaller than the size of the Higgs, and so it starts to, if you want, resolve the constituents of the Higgs. And what happens typically when you have a bound state and you eat it with a very high frequency, high wavelength, short wavelength wave, is that the guy becomes transparent to this wave. For instance, if you look at the data for proton electron-proton scattering, the ones from which it was discovered that the proton has a size, it was because the interaction with the photon, when you start reaching the proton size, starts becoming weaker. Okay? And so what you expect to see is that on this side of the curve, the contribution for this kind of wavelength to the Higgs mass is gonna go to zero. An alternative way to see this is that if I go much above the confinement scale, well, there is no Higgs, okay? There is no Higgs, physical Higgs. And so there is no, say, Higgs mass term to worry about, okay? And so there is not expected to be any quadratic sensitivity to this kind of energies above, much above the confinement scale. And in between, it will have a peak. And so you will have a scenario where the phenomenon of generation of the Higgs mass occurs is localized at the confinement scale. Okay. So the microscopic origin of the Higgs mass, compatibly with the hierarchy problem, is going to take place at an energy m star, which is not far from the TV scale. Okay, or well, the lighter the better, concerning the hierarchy problem, and so the the tension due to naturalness disappears. And what is important is, of course, that much higher energies quanta will not, okay, give mass to the Higgs because the Higgs does not exist at very high energies. Okay. So if you want, you solve the problem of masses of scalars, which is the hierarchy problem, by avoiding having scalars. Okay. By having scalars only at low energies. Okay. Clearly, it's very important for this to make sense. So basically, what we did is that we attached the phenomenon of Higgs mass generation to a scale, which is m star, which is not too heavy. That's what we did. Okay, we made the thing happen at a place where we can still be natural. But it's very important, of course, that the scale we attached the Higgs mass generation to should not be itself pushed by naturalness to very high scale. So it should be natural itself. Okay? Otherwise, and you can easily cook models where this happens, where you have a composite object, which, however, is made of a theory, which is whose confinement scale is itself set by a parameter, m star, which is not natural. And this wouldn't help at all. So the full picture that we have in mind is the following one. Okay, and it really relies on some strongly interacting composite sector, okay, with the following property. So. Yeah, the thing we want is to have one day a big UV picture for the generation of the electroweak scale. So we want a story that starts at an energy scale, which we call lambda UV, which is perhaps of the very same order of the gut scale, is very high. And at this scale, you will generate, perhaps by integrating out new physics even more heavy, a sector, a new physics sector that we call composite sector. And this composite sector have to have a special property, which is called dimensional transmutation. That is to say, it must be capable to generate a confinement scale M star, which is much below the UV theory where it is defined. Okay? We don't have to look too much to exotic examples. QCD is one of such examples. Okay? QCD is capable to naturally generate a big gap between the scale where QCD theory is defined. Where is this scale? Well, it could be, for instance, an effective QCD Lagrangian could be defined when you integrate out the W and you end up only with quarks and their coupling with say, let's say there is, or even above, right? QCD could be defined at very high scale and this would not be any problem, okay? And the way in which QCD behaves to do that is the following one. QCD starts at a very high scale where it is weakly interacting. Being weakly interacting means that it's close to a fixed point of the renormalization group evolution. Simply means that if it's close to being free, and the free theory doesn't run, doesn't do anything, stays the same at all scales. Okay? It is actually only close to this fixed point because it's not exactly free theory. It has a coupling, which is weak, which makes it move a little bit from the fixed point. Okay? This is the usual running coupling, okay, which goes from zero, or so to small, from small parameter but non-zero, it tends to become large. And it's only when it has become large that it can deform the theory radically, okay, and make it exit from the fixed point and lead to violent phenomena such as confinement. Okay? I say this in these complicated words in terms of fixed point and deformation around fixed points, okay? Because it's likely that it's possible, at least, that the composite sector of composite Higgs theory is actually not a plain QCD-like theory, in the sense it's not a theory which is close to the free fixed point in the UV, okay? It may be that it's a more general theory which has a fixed point of its, say, evolution, okay? But this fixed point is a strongly interacting fixed point. And there is a certain activity in trying to, in studying this kind of strongly interacting fixed point, perhaps also for this kind of applications, okay? But if you just want to understand where this gap comes from, just think to QCD and to the old textbook of dimensional transmutation, okay? So if you are sure that M star now is naturally much smaller than lambda UV, then you can try to build some, say, potentially realistic physics around this case. Okay? So what you need? Let me tell you the ingredients of the composite sector. We say that the Higgs must be a Goldstone boson, and the first ingredient that you need is a global group. I will take this group to be fully exact in the composite sector. So by definition, you may relax this assumption, but for simplicity, I'm going to consider the composite sector to be exactly invariant under an exact global group G. Okay? It is exact, and it's not even spontaneously broken in the UV, like in QCD, chiral symmetry is not broken. In the UV, but then when you go in the infrared, okay, there can be confinement, and there can also be spontaneous breaking of this group. But actually, we do expect this to happen, okay, generally speaking. And so here you will have a spontaneous symmetry breakdown, G broken to H. That occurs at M star, the infrared scale, the confinement scale of the strong theory, and in the breaking. The sure thing you know is that you are going to produce Goldstone bosons, and you want to choose the G and the H, okay? You want to find the theory where the G and the H are such that the Higgs belongs to this coset G over H, which means the Higgs is generated as one of the Goldstone bosons associated with this breaking. Then you need another piece of the world, which is the elementary sector. So what is the elementary sector made of? The elementary sector is made of all the particles that on one end we know they cannot be composite, they cannot be composite resonances by phenomenology, and on the other end the particles that do not give us problems with naturalness. So basically it's made by all the standard model particles minus the Higgs. So here you will have the fields that correspond to the standard model minus the Higgs doublet. So here you can really have the most general Lagrangian at D equal 4 with small corrections because, well, there is no Higgs mass term to worry about. There is no naturalness problem. There are not even Yukawas, however. And so this will be, because there is no Higgs. So generating the Yukawa will require, of course, communication between this side and this other side. And this sector then explicitly is made of the electro weak gauge bosons, W mu, B mu, the gluon. Okay? And these ones are gauge field, because we know that electroweak and gluon interactions are dictated by gauge invariants. It's just counting of degrees of freedom. It's not even phenomenology. So these guys have to be gauge fields. And there will be gauge fields associated with global symmetries that involve, of course, the elementary sector, but also the composite sector. In particular, the X has to be a doublet of the standard model group. And so we know that this composite sector has to carry electroweak quantum numbers. And the W mu and B mu and G mu will gauge part of this of these symmetries, of electroweak symmetries that we have also on this side. So this one will be coupled by gauging, for sure. Then there is the fermions, the left-handed and the right-handed fermions. The only possible exception is the right-handed top, which still could be an element, a composite guy. Okay? Well, and then, of course, you have to make these two things talk. So you have to make a hypothesis on what are the most relevant interaction you can write among this sector and this other sector. These interactions, L int, so these interactions are gauge interactions for what concerns the electroweak bosons and the gluons. Okay, they are coupled by gauging, so you already know that the interaction here for the gauge fields will be G global current of the corresponding symmetry on the composite sector times W mu. So this will be for sure the structure of the interaction of gauge fields. For the fermions, you have to make an hypothesis, and this hypothesis is what we call partial compositeness, and this I will explain next time. Please. Can you repeat?
Can you repeat what the TR question mark is?
Yes, it means that the right-handed top quark, the right-handed component of the top quark, could actually, perhaps is not here, but is there. Okay? The higher order, higher dimension operators, why are the
fundamental theory doesn't have the same series.
So the question was whether the standard model symmetry could be violated by higher dimensional operators. Well, symmetries like, I don't know, baryon number or lepton number, in general, of course, it could be violated by new physics, that is, by higher dimensional operators, okay? Lepton family number as well. The Weinberg operator, for instance, it violates lepton number, obviously. And clearly, if you do new physics at the TV scale, like here, okay, you have to forbid this to happen. Okay? So you have to impose that baryon and lepton number are symmetries, perhaps for a good reason, but they have to be symmetries of all this stuff. Okay? Okay. So basically, I'm basically done. Basically, this course will be about characterizing these two elements and the way they talk to each other and drawing the implication of this hypothesis. Just before concluding, I wanted to mention to continue also one second with the analogy with QCD, because I find this instructive. So the analogy with QCD is very close here, okay? So in QCD there is an exact global G. It's not really exact within the composite sector, because in QCD there are the quark masses. But suppose there are no quark masses. In QCD, it's a limit you can consider taking. Then QCD will be exactly invariant under some flavor group, the chiral group, take two flavor, SU2 left, SU2 right. QCD, the chiral group will be broken, and this, as correctly said, will generate the mass of the hadrons, the mass of the resonances, independently of the quark masses, and nothing to do with that. And there will be Goldstone bosons, which will be exactly massless from the viewpoint of QCD alone, which are the Goldstone bosons of QCD, the pions, okay? If you do two flavors. Also, the elementary sector has its own analogous, which is QED. So the photon, okay, is clearly not part of QCD, so it's part of the elementary sector. It is a gauge field, okay, like one of those guys, and it interacts by gauge coupling. So J electromagnetic of QCD, let's say, photon mu, okay? And also, well, also the electron and the muons, they are elementary guys, and they couple in a specific way to through the photon to QCD in a way that, by the way, resembles very much what we're going to discuss for the for the couplings of the fermions and of the gauge fields to the composite sector in composite ticks theory. Okay, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you. First question. Can afford a few seconds of awkward silence.
So tell me, why should it be that the top is special in being the composite one, rather than, and the, a little bit of bottom you said? Why not other quarks, or is this just an approximation?
There are two different things. When I say that the top right could be completely composite, it's because phenomenology suggests that it's not excluded, okay? This thing here. The fact that there could be not an elementary microscopic top right field. The top right could be a chiral resonance of the other side. That's just pure phenomenology. The other thing I said is that when we will discuss how to make these fermions interact with the composite sector, we will see that we are going to do this this partial compositeness hypothesis, and we will motivate this hypothesis, okay, in a way that you will see has to do with the top quark mass. So basically, we will see that to reproduce the top quark mass right, since it's so heavy, you cannot do with, say, the bilinear ways a la Technicolor, and the option that only people consider viable is the one of partial compositeness. Okay? So are two distinct things. Now you can shout.
So if the Higgs forms a multiplet, a Goldstone multiplet, how is your how is the Higgs potential formed? How is it generated?
Yes, the Higgs. The Higgs, of course, it's a Goldstone boson. It's an exact Goldstone boson because the symmetry is exact only from the viewpoint of this side here. Okay, but there is interactions and thank you for the question because. I wanted to finish, I forgot to mention. The interaction not only are important to make this sector communicate with this other, but they are so important because they transmit the breaking of the G symmetry, okay, to the composite sector, which was completely invariant. And this you immediately understand because I'm saying that there's going to be an enlarged global group on the composite sector under which the X is involved, and clearly there is not such a larger group in the standard model, okay? So the standard model fields, they feel incomplete multiplets of the G symmetry. And so necessarily their coupling with the composite sector will cause G-breaking. Okay? By the way, again, in analogy with QED, the QED photon only gauges one generator of the chiral group over three, and so it breaks it. Okay? So QED breaks chiral symmetry the same way coupling of these guys break the global symmetry. And then the Higgs overall will become a pseudo-number Wollaston boson. It will be entitled to have a tiny mass, some mass, and also, of course, the potential, which you will be able to compute within this framework, let's say, like there.
It somehow puzzles me that TR is composite and TL is not. Could you develop on this idea a little bit, please?
Plausible. What do you mean?
Puzzles me.
Puzzles you?
Yeah.
Well, it's the same question. Of course, if you're looking for flavor symmetries, okay, This will not help you. I mean, this is a breaking of the idea that flavor comes in a sort of universal way, and then it's differentiated. It gets differentiated by some structural mechanism. It's also true that flavor symmetric scenarios. We know many of them. This is a non flavor symmetric scenario. It's an alternative. It's a possibility. Okay? It's a possibility.
So I was wondering, you wrote down in the elementary sector just as the standard model fields?
Minus the Higgs.
Yeah. Is there going to be another elementary sector which would be related to the composite sector as well? Or is the composite Higgs in the end made up by the standard model fields? I was a bit confused about this.
So here there is the Higgs. So minus the Higgs plus the Higgs, which is here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So the Higgs will be delivered by as a resonance of this sector. As a Gorston of this sector. Okay? And so we don't need to put it here.
No.
We don't have to put it here. Otherwise, we reintroduce the hierarchy problem exactly as it was.
But you also don't have to extend the elementary sector to allow for this.
Now, that's a good question. You don't need, for model building reasons. You don't need. There are alternative ways to do this, in which you should extend also the elementary sector. Either because you want to practice model building, or because you want to enforce some other special property, like some additional cancellation in the Higgs potential, like in the Twin Higgs stuff. So there are some models in which you do extend also the elementary sector. For instance, realization of little Higgs, okay? Little Higgs is a composite Higgs of a special kind, okay? In little Higgs, the so-called top partners of little Higgs are actually elementary things coupled, so are additional elementary stuff here, okay? So in some cases, you may also want to do that.
Yeah, maybe a related question. Do people then also, because now you only focused on the hierarchy problem, but for instance, something like dark matter, can that also be solved in these models?
It's not particular. I don't find a particularly, there is not the equivalent of R parity. Of course, you can construct plenty of smart models, or even not so smart, in which naturally you do have the possibility to have a stable particle. Okay, like other Goldstones of the composite sector, and not all of them are really ad hoc. No, they're okay. I mean, I decided not to enter too much into model building, and also I don't find the equivalent of R parity of supersymmetry. In supersymmetry, there is really this big thing which is R parity, seems needed in all places. It also gives dark matter. Here, there is the dark matter can fit very well, but not at the same level.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so thank you again, Andrea.